This is a podcast by sciasmag.com.
Sciasmag, come out and play. Sciasmag, come out and play. Sciasmag, come out and play. Hello, 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 dear English thinking, hearing listener. Welcome back to me at the Science Mag, written Science MUG, the blog dash Twitter and Instagram accounts dash podcast dash stuff and go eShop on Zazzle.com that tells you science stories, competes in the 2019 Combing Stylist for Bald People contest with serious possibilities to get at least to the semifinals against an URL of Tuvalu, specialized in doing the perm to invisible wigs for particularly unsettling ceramic dolls. And that does all this in English? Question mark. A language that is to real English what Brexit and pizza with pineapples are to good ideas. And which talks to you thanks to the voice kidnapped via a voodoo wireless trick from a very, very, very dumb dude. In this episode, dear listener, it is going to end the story about three scientists, Mr. Sander, Dr. F-U-C-H-S, Prof. Milo, a.k.a. the Milo's team, who debunked the myth that in the human body, bacteria outnumber human cells by 10 to 1. The Milo's team first find out the actual number of bugs living in on the body of a reference human being, a healthy adult 1.7 meter high, 17 kilograms heavy, 20 to 30 years old male, aka Mr. Ref or Mr. Reference. This number, dear listener, is 3.9 × 10^14. The Milo's science guys then calculate the number of human cells that make Mr. Reference's body. And this number is, dear listener, 3 × 10^14. Now, to just clarify, dear listener, again, dear, 10^14 means a 1 followed by 14 zeros, which means your human body is made of 100,000 billion cells. In the Milky Way, there are, NASA says, about 100 billion stars, meaning that the cells that make your body, dear human listener, are 1,000 times more than all stars that make the whole galaxy. Okay, let's proceed with the episode. After calculating the just mentioned numbers, our fine researchers can thus show that the real bacteria versus human cells ratio in the human body is not 10 to 1 as thought for ages, but indeed an almost perfect 1 to 1, which is a ratio so finely balanced that every time one of you, dear human beings, go number 2, well, human cells end up winning the ratio competition, since every number 2 initiative, let's call it like this, means losing 1/3 of the members of the bacteria gang. So, to finish the story of the Milo's team, dear listener, and for this podcast to go back and train for the 2019 Combing Stylist for Bald People contest, which first prize is a tour of all the 49 major sites of the Dominion, dot having a ball, oh yeah, big time, yeah, yeah. To finish the story, only 2 questions must be answered. Those questions you smart-ass listener, probably asked yourself, your monster from the idea of reference, and implicit me. And those 2 questions are 1. Okay, the bugs versus human cell ratio is 1 to 1 in Mr. Reference body. But what about the non-Mr. Refs all around the world, like, for instance, women, overweight people, and babies? And question number 2. Why? Why the Milo's science trio invests so much time in understanding what's the actual bacteria versus human cell ratio in the human body instead of, I don't know, looking for answers to some essential biological and philosophical questions of life? Like, for instance, the reason why your dearest bladder always tells you that you have to pee be, you have to be the exact very moment you start being in slash into a place slash situation slash piece of apparel which does not allow you to be at all. Well, dear listener, here come the answers. Answer to question 1. As you by now know, if not, well, listen to part 1 and 2 of the episode. As by now you know, the bacteria versus human cell ratio basically depends on colon volume and bugs density in the colon for the bugs site, and the number of red blood cells, aka erythrocytes, that's the hematocrit, and blood volume for the human cell size. Okay? Okay. So let's start with women, lady first. According to the 2002 publication by the International Commission of Radiological Protection, the ICRP2, a standard 1.73 meter tall lady reference has a colon volume of about 430 milliliters. That is similar to the about 410 milliliters colon volume of the standard 1.70 meter tall Mr. reference. As for the bugs density in the colon, well, science literature doesn't report so far any gender-specific differences about this parameter. Let's go to the hematocrit and blood volume now. Lady Ref has a hematocrit and a blood volume respectively 10% and 20-30% lower than those of Mr. Reference. So putting together these values, the Milos team expects the bacteria to human cell ratio to increase by about a third in women. Big guys, here we come. In obese people, the colon volume increases with weight and plateau at about 600 milliliters. It is about 50% higher than that of the standard man value, and the bugs density in the colon is similar to that of Mr. Reference. As for the human cell count, well, obesity implicates an increase of adipose tissue, and this tissue grows in two ways. The adipocytes stretch and get very big, hypertrophy, and also they grow in number, hyperplasia. So as for the hypertrophy, well, dear listener, you see for yourself that the cell count doesn't change with this, they got bigger, not more. As for hyperplasia, yep, in this case the fat cells numbers goes actually up. However, as said in the previous parts of the episode, the Milos team has shown that adipocytes in Mr. Reference are a negligible 0.2% of the total amount of human body cells. So even if their number rises a bit in overweight people, that doesn't impact on the final cell count in any sensible way. Moreover, fat tissue is not much vascularized, that is, it has not many blood vessels. This implies that even when the body weight of overweight people is 100 to 400% higher than Mr. Reference 1, it has 140 to 280 kilograms versus 70 kilograms, well, their total blood volume increases only by 40 to 80%. Thus, dear visitor, in the big guys, to an increase of colon volume and therefore bugs number corresponds a more or less equal increase of blood volume and therefore of blood cells. So final result, the bugs versus human cell ratio of obese people is substantially the same of Mr. Fit Refs 1. Okay, now let's talk about babies.
Wow, this sentence is scary as hell, even for a non-human blog dash podcast like I am. Okay, from infancy to adultness, the bugs density in the colon is rather constant. Colon volume, of course, is a different beast. On top of this, according to the Milos lab guys, there is a knowledge gap about this specific issue. The only data available are in fact derived only from comparing infant to adult daily fecal output values. That is, dear at this point probably grossed out listener, the amount of poop coming out from a baby in a day versus the amount of poop coming out from an adult. Intensity of the smell is not a considered parameter. Thus, not coming from more precise measurements, these data on colon volumes of babies versus adults are less reliable than needed. Anyway, so far these data say that neonates have a colon volume of 50 milliliters and 1 year old babies have a colon volume of 80 milliliters. So basically, babies' colon volumes are 5 to 8 times
smaller than that of Mr. Adult Ref. Now let's go to the number of red blood cells - erythrocytes, i.e. the hematocrit, and blood volume. Baby's hematocrit is higher than that of normal adults, but it decreases during the first 2 months until it levels at 10% lower than adult values. On the other hand, the blood volume to weight ratio of infants is approximately 10% higher than normal adults. So, considering also the fact that the bugs density in the colon of elders is 25% lower than that of our 20 to 30 years old Mr. Ref, but the hematocrit is the same, and putting all these just mentioned data together, the Milos Science guys conclude that the effect of age on the bugs versus humans ratio is smaller than twofold from age 1 year onward, and probably within the variation they estimated across the population of standard adult males. To sum up, then, dear, dearest listener, according to the Milos team, the answer to your first question is the bugs versus human cells ratio is more or less 1-to-1 also in women, overweight people, and children. Now, let's go to your question number 2, but only after a commercial break.
We could come up with some sly, alluring slogan to get to you and convince you to buy our product. We are good at that. We just convinced Dime Beetle in Micronesia to purchase a lifelong subscription to a monthly review for Genphobics, and an ant colony from Minnesota to buy a 72 lessons course that teach the philosophy of Japanese baboon from the 13th century that is all about how to affirm your own self and not to conform to the mass will. But we won't do it! We just say that there are lots of cool shirts, cases, hats, gadgets, and other stuff at our e-shop, Stop and Go, on Zazzle.com. And that if you want them, well, you can have them all. Legally, I mean.
Okay, my pal listener, now the time has come to answer your second question. Why the Milos team works so hard to understand what be the actual bacteria versus human cells ratio in the human body? Well, firstly, the more you know about the bugs living in - on you, even just their total number, dear human listener, the better in general. That's because you naked monkeys are ecosystems, and bacteria are part of them, of you, and absolutely essential for your well-being. Take the gut bugs, for instance. They make energy for you. They stimulate the development of your skin. They make some key nutrients and minerals more easily available for you lazy-ass host. They help the development of your immune system and even reduce the risk of asthma and dermatitis. They basically rock. So again, the more you know of your bugs, the better it is for you. Besides, as for the Milos team, hang up for the total amount of human cells, well, they're kinda justified on these two, given a 2015 study shows that the cells number matters a lot. Indeed, the number of stem cells of specific tissues - organs, i.e. those cells that can self-renew and are responsible for the development and maintenance of the tissue's architecture, the number of these stem cells of specific tissue - organs, and the number of their divisions in time is highly and positively linked to the lifetime risk of insurgence of cancer in those tissues - organs. So, dear listener, as you can see, the Milos lab coats have plenty of good reasons to embark in their research project. Moreover, in the very own words of the Milos team, a number, that's the 10-to-1 bugs versus human cells, widely stated they should be based on the best available data, serving to keep the quantitative biological discourse rigorous. So, dear listener, let me conclude the answer to your second question on the reason of this research, quoting the cool final words of Professor Milo and colleagues' paper. We think that the kind of progression presented in this study, from informative back-of-the-envelope calculation to more nuanced value estimates, is of wide interest and is instructive in the quantitative training of biologists. In performing this kind of calculation, we become intimately familiar with the limits of our current understanding and therefore more easily highlight the best avenues for scientific progress in a particular field. What better place to start such quantitative training than by examining the contents of the human body? In doing so, we can comply with the Delphic maxim of know thyself in a truly quantitative fashion. Poetry, folks. Science poetry. Ciao!